Wow, hotter than heck here. Another day in the 100. Welcome everybody, love and welcome to everyone, because this channel, this video, is really a call to repentance. And what's repentance is to say, I don't have a confusion problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a catastrophe problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a panic problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a world problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a mortification problem, I have a continuity problem. I don't have a procrastination problem, I have a continuity problem. The call to repentance is to insist that the only problem I have, we all have, is a continuity problem. That is repentance. As soon as we do this, we feel that we are with God, with the Holy Spirit, with truth, with wisdom. We're in the company of the wise. Just like that. As soon as we make these statements with will and assertion and intent, yes, you know, I do not have a confusion problem. I have a severe continuity problem. It starts smoothing out. Clarity starts smoothing out your perspective. Just instantly, really. It may be very subtle, but I can feel it just like that. I woke up this morning and I had to use this because there's some very intense situations about to occur. Will there be a false flag? Yes, most likely a false flag situation is coming. That this is what people have been warning us about, telling us about. Now, but what's new with this world, right? What's new with this world? So is a catastrophe, is a manufactured catastrophe coming? Very likely, yes. So what we say is, I do not have a catastrophe problem, I have a continuity problem. And therefore, you don't need to have catastrophe consciousness. It's amazing the wisdom it opens up. But it's totally mellow wisdom. There's no pressure on it. You can just look for yourself. And you say, wow, this is a different perspective. I only have a continuity fear. That's the only trouble I have, really. It's the only trouble I have. But it's big trouble, for sure. But it's not complex, it's not confusing, it's just, I see, wow, I'm, you know, it's kind of scary to drop fear. no fear, only happiness. It's difficult to drop perception and only oneness, you see. There's a continuity fear. It makes all the difference. It makes all the difference. You can go from panic to poise. Simply by repenting, saying, I do not have a panic problem, I have a continuity problem. And don't ask, you insist upon it. You're the one, you're insisting that this is truth. I'm insisting this is truth. I do not have a panic problem. I do have a severe continuity problem, and I'm working on that with the Holy Spirit, with the grace of God, with the voice of reason, the voice of clarity. So I continuously call everyone to the same repentance, to say, I do not have this problem, I have a continuity problem, whatever problem you might say it is, I do not have any problem except the continuity problem. No exceptions. Insist, 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 and then you be amazed at your wisdom, and how easy wisdom is at that point. You can't get it the other way. You know, you end up with the form of wisdom, but not the content. Not the content. I see a lot of that. It's those appearances of being wise. But when you get down the nitty-gritty here and start talking, no, they don't want to talk because they're not really wise. They're not really wise. They cannot see the big picture, really. They haven't repented. Haven't repented. It's a spiritual ambition. Our problem started with spiritual ambition. Okay. Now, by we, I mean spirit. Now, obviously, we see male and female bodies here in this world. In different feminine nature, masculine nature, and all this. That is all still 100% spiritual ambition. Spiritual ambition leads to the desire to be greater than God. Is spiritual ambition. That leads to perception. We made perception. Perception distorts what we're seeing. It's a hallucination, actually. And bodies are these excellent devices what we can blame perception on. Actually, bodies are not really perceiving. They're instruments of perception, but the one that's really perceiving is the desire of spiritual ambition, is perceiving, blaming it on the body, essentially. So we become addicted to bodies. Our pride builds this addiction to bodies and to perception. And then this addiction to bodies and perception leads to a continuity problem. Because we're so used to this, we're afraid to drop the hallucination, which is duality, which is more and less. That's far. When a body, you say, well, this is closer to me, and something else is farther away. Right? This is closer, this is farther away to the body. This is closer and farther away. That's duality. This is bigger, this is smaller. All the qualities of form. This is clear to me, this is not, this is fuzzy, it's farther away. You know, all this stuff. But what is the sameness of everything? It's all occupying the same spaciousness. Perfect spaciousness. That's all exactly the same. See, that's the truth of the situation. The perception overlooks this, overlooks the truth of sameness of everything, actually. It overlooks everything's made of gold, so to speak, and is constantly obsessed with the differences of this. Well, this is nearer to me, this gold's nearer, that gold's farther away, I can see this better, I can hear this better, I can't hear that as well, I can taste this better, I can't taste that. And this is the delusion of duality, relativity. So we're addicted to all this. And to just say, hey, I have a severe continuity problem, is an admission that, yeah, I did have spiritual pride, I did make perception in bodies, I did get addicted to it, and so that has led to a severe continuity problem. And so this is just honesty with God. And as soon as you do that, you're on the same page with God. And God says, great, the Holy Spirit will help you, don't worry. No pressure, don't have to do it, whenever you're ready, that's fine. That's what the light of God says. Whenever you're ready, I'm here to help, and we'll talk, and it's no problem whatsoever. This is repentance. Not many like, you know, repentance is difficult because we're embarrassed. We, you know, like for instance, let's say you, after a lifetime of effort, like for my instance of trying to repent, I'm still coming up short of complete repentance. It's very embarrassing because I've been trying my entire life and failing. Mortifying, really. Now, people see this and they say, hey, I'm smart, I'm more clever than you are. I just won't repent. And there's no mortification then, because they're not going to even try. And they'll say, you're inferior because you spent 50 years trying, and or however long, and you still haven't done it completely, so you're really a big failure. And I say, well, what about you? And they say, well, I haven't tried it yet. I'm sure I can do it easy. No problem. I just not quite ready to, not quite feel like doing it yet, but I'm sure I wouldn't have any problem with it. So they never get around to it, is the thing, because they're afraid that if they try and they have difficulty, that brings to light the fact that they have been suffering from spiritual ambition, pride, did make bodies and perception, are addicted to sensuality, bodies, perception. It shows that, you know, they've been very addicted to it. That's why they're failing in their repentance. So most of us don't even try, and we think we're outsmarting the situation. They say, well, I'm not embarrassed at all. Me? No. I just haven't even tried yet. You know, but I'll get around to it soon. When I do, they snap. They're waiting to do it easily, so they're not embarrassed. And the others who, again, another way is to simply say, well, there is no God, there is no repentance, there's nowhere to go back to, so I got no embarrassment, I got no shame, no mortification, you know, and nothing to try. There's nothing to try. So one says, well, I haven't tried yet, but when I do, it'll be easy. And the other says, there's nothing to try. And so they don't get around to it. The ones that get around to it are the ones that keep trying. And it's you know, it is difficult because you think, wow, it's so embarrassing. You've been working so long. You sometimes just feel like just killing yourself and say, this is too embarrassing. You know, at least I can say, well, I died and I only failed for 30 years. Whereas if I keep living, I might fail for 50 or 60 years. You know, it's very embarrassing. So it is like that. It is quite embarrassing. There's no good. That is true, because you know, it just shows how addicted to sensory perception, body sensory perception, spiritual pride that we have become. It's like, wow, I'm still working on it. Wow, you know, it's terrible. Well, that's the fact. That's the fact that we our spiritual pride, ambition certainly has pushed us, you know, took us way into dualistic delusion, way into a severe hallucination, no question about it. But the fact is that those who try, their addiction is less. It's actually less. They've lessened it a lot. So at least they can think, you know what, if I just try for a whole lifetime, maybe I'll succeed. And at least at the end, maybe I'll get some point, I'll be able to succeed. It won't be completely embarrassing. So we're all struck with this trouble. And they say, well, how quick can I repent? How quick can I repent? Well, we can get the sense of repentance immediately. Anyone can. But as far as, you know, completing the repentance with the vision of oneness, which is the completion of the path of repentance, the only path there is the path of repentance. When's that, the vision of oneness comes? Well, it comes when you're ready for it. It comes when you're ready for it. And it may take a long time. It may take a long time. But don't be mortified by that. It just means the continuity fear is still quite acute. But you have tools. You know, how long does it take to build a house? Well, you're going to build a house a lot quicker if you have the power tools, right? Than if you didn't have any. If you're just going to do it with your hands and fingernails, you know, good luck with that. Stones, you know. But if you've got power tools, then you can do it pretty quickly. So this technique of I do not have a confusion problem, I have a continuity problem, is very tremendous technique to use. Instant centering. So the call to repentance is what it's all about. This call is to everyone. It's to everyone. Now, we've said that people have this embarrassment, shame, mortification problem, like not being able to reach the vision of oneness real quick. That shows that they've been addicted to sensuality. You know, it shows up. So they want to avoid it. They want to avoid the whole issue of repentance. So they're willing to listen, very keen to listen to anyone who says, hey, guess what? You don't have to really repent. The problem is something else. They're eager for that kind of information. Well, that kind of information is called the big lie. The big lie is what it is. And the big lie is being told in the world right now by all the big lie storytellers. And it's being lapped up by those people who are so afraid of feeling like, wow, you know, showing that their addiction shows up in their path because they can't finish it real quick. You know, these people say, okay, how long is it going to take me here? Sure, I'm interested in enlightenment. How long? Can I do it, like, you know, a couple weeks? You know, I mean, I'm a, you know, I, other than anything longer than that, it's going to hurt my image, you know? I'm a person of success. It's a couple of weeks, you know, I should be able to do it. You know? And so they want it fast. Well, they're very much vulnerable to the big lie. Now, I've already worked so long on this. I'm not so vulnerable. It's already been extremely embarrassing. I've been severely embarrassed and mortified, you know, just terribly. So I am not so vulnerable to the big lie. I'm able to see it. Now, the big lie is to say, you know what? You don't really have to repent. Oh, really? People say, oh, really? I don't have to repent. Oh, great. Great news. Why? Well, the big lie, as it's being told now, is to say, hey, everyone, did you know, everyone, that spiritual ambition, which is the root of all our suffering, all our misery, okay, that is the root of it, spiritual ambition, they say, did you know that spiritual ambition in females is perfectly fine? There's no problem with that whatsoever. It's only male spiritual ambition that needs to be repented. Females don't need to be repented at all. Okay. So if you put them in charge, you know, everything will be fine. And in fact, they have the power of absolution. And if you're the way they want you to be, ask you to be, you won't have to repent either. Your spiritual ambition will be transmuted, and it will be an okay thing because it's serving female spiritual ambition, which is no problem at all. See, that's not a problem. This is called the big lie. This is called the big lie. And this is what's being sold to this world at this time. And again, people are extremely vulnerable to it because they don't want to be embarrassed on the spiritual path. I'm not vulnerable to it because I've already been so badly embarrassed, you know. It's just like, okay, another embarrassment. All right, whatever. Another day of failure. What's new? So I see right through it. I see right through it. It's not misogynistic. It's clergenistic. I call it clergenistic. Clergenistic means seeing clearly the feminine role, the female role that they play, the house of female spiritual ambition plays out, because it plays out in a very sneaky way. You see, the femininity is very sneaky. The female aspect of this, it takes tremendous pride in being sneaky and manipulative. That's how their spiritual ambition tends to manifest. Men tend to be more direct. Their spiritual ambition is more direct, okay? And the female is more indirect. Same spiritual ambition. It's just the dichotomy of the duality of how to play direct and indirect, the yin and the yang, okay? But the yin and the yang is all the same spiritual ambition, and the same repentance is necessary, absolutely necessary, because the same continuity problem exists. It's the exact same continuity problem, same fear. Doesn't matter if you're direct or indirect. So if females were being told, oh, because they're indirect and sneaky, they're able to do false flag maneuvers, for instance, where, let's say, females want to get something that someone has, like a male, something, they want to get it for their sensual, dualistic, spiritual ambition, desire. They want to increase that sense of their ambition, successful ambition. But they say, hey, I'm very sneaky and smart, so I'm going to figure out a way to get someone to get it for me. I'm not going to get it myself. I'll get someone to get it for me. So, in simplest terms, it can get very complex. In simplest terms, they make a deal with someone else. Let's say that there's one strong man here, another strong man over here. They'll go to the second strong man and say, hey, look, you want what that strong man wants, right? The other guy's got that, right? You want it. And the strong man may say, nah, not really. I got the fight, you know, it's a really terrible thing. I'm pretty happy. And then she'll say, well, wait a minute. I mean, I'm like really taken with you, but I'm not quite taken with you enough, you know. It's just, I feel like you could be so amazing, like a god, and I could be your goddess, you know. It's just incredible, but I just feel you're not quite ambitious enough. And she works on the ego of that second, you know, strong man, until the second strong man says, yeah, wow, I could have it all, you know. So their spiritual ambition gets going, and then she says, look, here's the plan. You attack that second strong, the other strong man that I want to get their stuff. You attack them, but attack them in a, I'll show you a sneaky way to do it, so nobody knows who attacked them or what really happened, okay? And then she says, okay, now listen, I'll take responsibility for the attack. I'll say, I'm the one who did it. Then the strong man that was attacked is going to come after me, okay, and try to attack me. And then you can rush in to protect me, okay, and use that as a pretext to attack the other strong man, because you see, the reluctance of this strong man to attack the other is to say, hey, if I just direct naked aggression, and just come in there and attack, the whole world's gonna come down on me, right? I'm gonna be condemned. I can't do that. I can't just seize what they have, you know? That's no good. She says, no problem. Here's how we'll do it. You attack them sneakily. I'll accept responsibility for it. They'll then protect me, and it's justified, and the world will say, sure, it's justified, it's okay. Now, once you defeat them, okay, I get half, you get half. See, I get half, you get half. Right? Now, what, okay, she didn't do any of the attacking, right? None of the stuff. Didn't do the first attack, didn't do the second attack to protect her. Didn't do anything, hands clean. Now, if it all falls apart, you know, it's pretty easy. So why did I says, you know what? The truth is I didn't have anything to do with it at all. That they actually attacked, and the first attack was them, not me. My hands are clean, lily white, pure. And then she'll have evidence. She makes sure she has evidence that the strong man that she kind of seduced into this actually carried out the first attack too. So she can say, look, actually, I had nothing to do with it. He forced me into accepting responsibility for it. So if it goes wrong, she's got all the way, the easy way to wiggle out of the situation. This is how it works. This is how the female spiritual ambition is very clever, manipulative, and sneaky. And that's why I call clergyny, not misogyny, clergyny. I'm very clergynistic. I'm very clergynistic in being able to see this. So that certainly needs to repent, doesn't it? I mean, that to say like, oh, no, women don't have any spirit. Their spiritual ambition hasn't caused any problems. Well, it's caused most of the conflict and wars throughout history, actually. And the constant, you know, people at each other's throat. The greed, the lust, of material lust and greed and sensuality. So I want that, I want that, I want that, I want that. How do I get that? Oh, I can get someone else to get it, steal it, grab it for me, get it, and I can get somebody in. Constantly manipulating the situation like that, and then insisting that they're innocent, pure, and they had nothing to do with it. But wisdom sees right through that nonsense. Right through that nonsense. Now, it's easier to see men's spiritual ambition because it's more direct. And so they get blamed like, oh, you see, the men are the bad ones. Women are, they're okay, don't worry about that. Well, the Holy Spirit sees it all as one. And the Holy Spirit knows that this addiction to spiritual ambition, whether male or female, yin or yang, brings the same continuity fear to it. So the need of repentance is for everyone. Need of repentance is for everyone. Not just for men, it's for women and men equally. They have to repent equally. I mean, in other words, total repentance. There's no exception for anyone. I have to turn to, I have a continuity problem. I don't have any other problem but a continuity problem, and then work on it. And of course, a man will be mortified, like, I didn't do it quick. So a woman will be extremely mortified, like, basically will go and say to the teacher, hey, look, you know, I've been here for a couple years, and I'm still not enlightened. This is way too embarrassing for me, because I mean, my spiritual ambition hasn't been very much at all, right? And the longer I take, the more people start thinking, hey, why is she taking so long here? Maybe she was very ambitious, spiritually ambitious. Just, no, I was. I had nothing to do with any of this, you know. Not being honest about how manipulative they have been. So they tend to then try to manipulate the teachers. So the teachers blackmail them, essentially. So the teacher will say, oh, yeah, you're enlightened. And then say, well, give me a high position here. You know, I'm going to go out and teach, you know. Give me your blessing so I can show the world that I'm enlightened quickly. There's very few that want to spend a lifetime of effort at this, you know, because it brings to light that their spiritual ambition. In this world, it seems as though women don't have much spiritual ambition. It's not true at all. They have tremendous spiritual ambition. Tremendous. They're the ones who give birth to bodies. They're the ones who market sensuality to keep us attracted to bodies. And bodies are the mechanism we use to blame our hallucination on, which shows us duality, which makes it seem that our spiritual ambition is justified. It's justified. It's a way to justify our spiritual ambition. And of course, women overwhelmingly are the ones who market attractive body sensuality in the world. Overwhelmingly. Beautiful clothes, beautiful look, beautiful attitude, beautiful body language, beautiful talk. Say, look how beautiful I am. Look how beautiful the body is. Look how wonderful it is, you know. Sensuality, sensuality, sensuality. They're the ones who market sensuality to the world. So they're extremely ambitious, spiritually ambitious. Because this is an expression of spiritual ambition. Meaning, hey, I can't be greater than God. And here's the proof. The body's showing me the proof of this. It's justifying my ambition. And it hasn't been getting better. It's been getting way, way worse in this world. Way worse. It's shockingly worse. As this big lie, people buy in, have bought into this big lie. So be clergenistic, not misogynistic, clergenistic, which is a call to repentance for the yin and the yang, to all spiritual ambition of all types, all of that, all body identification, all types. I don't care, transgender, it doesn't make any difference. It's all body identification that leads to continuity problems. Period. Doesn't matter what body you identify. Part of the big lie is that women perceive differently. You know, they say they're holistic, intuitive, nurturing, caring, unifying. Like they perceive in a different way. This nonsense is part of the marketing of this sort of thing. Totally bogus in terms of the continuity problem. Perception, body identification leads to severe continuity problem. Women see something up close and they say, oh no, I see something, you know, other side of the world exactly the same as I'm seeing this. And this is utter nonsense. It's part of the big lie. They see dualistically just as much as men see dualistically, but they're able to spin it in a way that seems not quite as directly dualistic. All right, it's more indirectly, sneakily dualistic, so to speak. It's the same dualism. It's the same dualistic, more and less, more and less, more and less. Do they see light constantly everywhere? When it turns nighttime, they don't see any darkness. Is that true? I mean, this is so crazy. What the lie we're being told, that somehow female spiritual ambition is good. It's fine. It's not a problem. It doesn't lead to a continuity problem. This is the big lie. It leads to a severe continuity problem, very severe. And those who buy into this big lie are going to be saddled with an incredible bad situation. The Holy Spirit pointed out to me yesterday in a most direct way, and I was just like, wow, there's this couple came into church and came right in front of us, and it was symbolizing what's in front of us, what's in the future of this world, what's in front of us. And it was immediately I picked up on it, and I said, wow, who are these people? They didn't fit at all there. They came in late, they didn't fit, and the guy was like a zombie. I could tell he was like a third world zombie, completely controlled by the woman. And the woman was using sensuality to control him. It was completely obvious, the whole thing. And this is what's in front of us in this world, is females using their spiritual ambition to market sensuality to basically those men who are afraid of repentance, they don't want to be embarrassed, to enslave them, to really enslave them. This guy was enslaved. He was enslaved. He was a slave to sensuality. And that's easily, the man then can be easily manipulated. And his ambition then easily can be turned to acquire stuff from the female, to attack some other male. And use this false flag, this whole, you know, clever manipulative situation to get stuff to the female, that she's the one who really wants it, and that she doesn't have to get her hands dirty doing any of that stuff. So it's leading to a horrible, horrible world. And the Holy Spirit showed me this is the condition of men in the world to come. I was just like, scared the heck out of me. Scared the heck out of me. It was like a slave, third world slave. He was like a zombie. Yeah. It's just like, wow. Yeah. The guy is totally had bought into this Kool-Aid. He totally drank the Kool-Aid, the big lie that's being told right now. Didn't want to be embarrassed, you see. And, of course, once the women get control like that, they say, you want enlightenment? Oh, okay, go ahead. You know, how long is it going to take you? Well, don't take long. And so if it takes a little longer than a few days, they say, well, how come you didn't get enlightened? He says, you're embarrassing me. Why? Well, because people might think that I've been controlling you, sensuality, some which is, of course, nonsense. I'm not doing any of that. He says, why are you having such trouble? You shouldn't have any trouble. I say, well, you better stay away from that. That makes me look bad. You know, that's what happens. So you have a situation where repentance disappears on the planet. When this feminine spiritual ambition it gets looked at as the savior, which is what it's being marketed as. It's being marketed as our savior, feminine spiritual ambition. It's being marketed as our savior. When that happens, true repentance disappears from the planet, and the men turn into slaves, and they're terrified because they don't want to embarrass the woman by having difficulty repenting. So, you know, it reflects poorly on the woman, right? Because it points out her spiritual ambition. So you have this very negative situation taking place, very negative. And all you can get is just a form, some kind of, you know, empty forms of spirituality is what happens. Say, so, yeah, man, go ahead and do that. You can have these empty forms. And then the men are just these empty forms of spirituality. And then they get blamed. They say, look, they're incompetent, etc. But again, once this gets bad, it gets real bad. Real bad. So, you know, basically most men have to kind of take the spiritual path, and nobody even knows they're taking the path. Otherwise, the women would say, oh, you're on a spiritual path? Great. Oh, that's really cool. I mean, I'm really happy for you. It's great. You know, how long do you think it'll take you? Immediately you can feel their spiritual ego ambition jump up and jump in there and say, wait a minute, you know, what if it starts taking a long time and people start wondering, hey, you know, maybe, you know, you've really been hooked into sensuality for a long time, and why, who hooked you, how, you know, who's involved with you in this? And they start getting real worried about that. And they say, well, you gotta complete this fast, you know, a couple seminars, you should do it. Otherwise, people start looking at the female and saying, hey, you know, what role are you playing? What about your spiritual ambition? They say, no. I'm already perfect. What are you talking about? I don't need to repent. It's the man that needs to repent. So, men, you want to go repent? Go repent. But do it quick. Do it quick. Can't do it quick like that. So, I was shown the future. What's the future in this? Holy cow, on this planet. Shocking. Shocking. I was very affected by that. Good God. That is bad. Horrible. This female is one of those sensual females that every single motion she does is sensual to. It's like cluing, triggering the guy this way, or other. A little tug of the skirt, tug of this. You know, just every way she's positioning, moving, is total control. Total sensual control. Totally. You know, 100% into that. I was like, whoa. You know, that's not what anybody wants or needs, really. That's not good for repentance at all. So a lot of times, male and females need to be separated out because they have this, again, extreme codependency of I'm afraid to repent, you're afraid to repent, you know, and it just gets worse and worse and builds and builds and builds, and nobody's willing to do it at all. And men are so controlled through female sensuality, the women can blackmail them and say, "Hey, if you embarrass me, I'll cut you off, and you'll feel unable to function. I won't give you any of the clues of how to function. Do this now, do that now. This is what sensuality likes. This is what the body likes." And we see we make a god of our own desire. The god that most people are praying to is the god of our own desire. We're just imagining that our desire is a god. And this god instructs us of how to remain identified with the body so that we can continue our whimsical charade of, you know, our spiritual ambition of being greater than God. We can continue on with it because we see, oh, there's light and dark, and there's good and bad, and there's big and small, and there's different differences, dualistic differences. I need to get the good and discard the bad. You know, it justifies it. So, to be threatened that you're going to be cut off from the body, cut off from sensuality. So the man says, whoa, I won't know how to function. The continuity fear kicks up like that. It kicks up real bad. So historically, the genders were separated in spiritual practice. So this terrible codependency, this conspiracy between the yin and the yang could begin to dissipate. So the man would not feel so scared about taking too long, you know. And the women could also feel like, you know what, it's okay if I start getting repentance. It might take me a while. The man she's embarrassed, like, you know, how's a man gonna look at me now? Because realizing how what a controlling sensualist I was. So it's better if the genders are separated out. Actually, it's better. And eventually, you know, be necessary again. Is this? I mean, those two, that couple there, they'd have to be separated out for sure. The dynamic, I could just, was they were so completely locked into, it was just destroying both of them. One of them was so controlled, the other was so controlling, you know, and those are both developed severe continuity problems, identification with sensory perception. Perception of the sensuous. Sensuality means sensuality. Addicted to the senses. The touch, the hearing, the seeing, the tasting, the smelling, the senses, you know, what we're sensing through the body, so to speak. Addiction to that is sensuality. Sensuality is what produces the severe continuity issue. Perception, a form. We're blind. We're blind. Perception is blindness, actually. We're hallucinating blindness is what we're really doing. If you want to know what perception is, it's an hallucination of blindness. The oneness is completely apparent. It's here all the time, and we don't see it. We're blind to it. We're hallucinating a blindness to this. And we keep that hallucination going by identifying with the body. We do that through sensuality, making the body seem attractive. Pleasurable, attractive. Oh, I like this body. Beautiful body. Bodies are beautiful. That kind of thing. Bodies, that's sensuality, and that's how we stay deluded, and we do not repent. So we have to go away from that and say, I do not have a sensuality problem. I have a continuity problem. See? But the issue is, how long does it take to get to the vision of oneness? Well, you can do it this instant, actually. But usually, it takes quite a long time to iron out the, you know, continuity fear, to evaporate the continuity fear. And if you have this very strong lack of repentance going on and say, oh, no, this spiritual ambition, I wasn't spiritually ambitious, I didn't cause you any, I didn't, I wasn't involved in this dance of sensuality, no way, and don't want to be embarrassed, you know, by someone taking long, then you got a severe problem. You got a severe issue that is, you know, working against you, actually. It's working against you. The more you get into sensuality, the more this issue comes up, is neither party wants to admit their part in it, you see. And generally speaking, the more sneaky, manipulative, feminine aspect of the yin and yang is able to come out smelling like a rose. Like, almost always, the women are able to manipulate the situation where they're really not to blame. They didn't have any role in it. And they love to get to the point where they had no role, completely innocent, even though we know they're manipulating the entire situation. And promising the man this, promising the man that, love, happiness, sensuality, good, great stuff, freedom, whatever. And turning the man, look at this, you could have this, you know, stoking the fire. And behind the scenes, you know, doing so much, and yet they want everyone to believe they never did do anything. No spiritual ambition at all. Well, if that's the case, they should be able to accept repentance, and the vision of oneness should come immediately. And until they say, well, sure, I could do that. I just don't feel like it. I just don't feel like it now. Why are you pressing me? I just don't feel like it. Because if they tried and it didn't come immediately, then people say, oh, wait a minute, maybe you were more involved with all this sensuality than you're claiming. Right? so the path of repentance is forgiveness. We say, look, everybody has been incredibly involved in perception, body identification. Why, who are we kidding? Yeah, you don't need to say, oh, no, not me. everybody has a gigantic continuity problem through long, long identification with perception. And the more we deny this, the worse it gets. So forgiveness, forgiveness, forgiveness. Nobody is, you know, judging someone and saying you're bad or something. Say, no, repent, repent, repent. And it's going to take a while. Don't get tricked by the ego saying, wait a minute, I'm embarrassed by this. I don't want anybody to think that I was anything less than perfect before. So you get those who don't want to repent, for sure. A little misperfect. Doesn't want to repent. What are you talking about? It's the men that need to repent. I've never done anything. I'm never identified. I've never done anything I need to repent for. Well, how about the spiritual ambition of identifying with the body? How about the spiritual ambition of perceiving? Perception is spiritual ambition. It is blindness. Hallucinating blindness is perception. How about that? I said, wow, you're crazy. I don't know what you're talking about. Whew, gone. Like that. So, those who say, wait, those who are calling for repentance, say, hey, wait a minute. They're both the yin and the yang, the whole thing. We all have a severe continuity problem. They're being shouted down by those who are promoting the New World Order, which is really spiritual pride, spiritual ambition. They say, hey, we don't got any problem. What are you talking about? It's just the men had a problem. The females, no problem at all. We're going to build a perfect society, okay, based on the female, the egoless female, right? No spiritual ambition. She knows exactly how to do everything right. And if anybody says, oh, well, wait a minute, the Holy Spirit hasn't said that to me. They say, you're misogynistic. You're misogynistic. You are attacking women. You have a war against women. You're evil. I say, well, wait a minute. The Holy Spirit doesn't say I'm evil. Yeah. It sounds like you're the ego lying to this. Lying, saying you're carrying out spiritual pride and ambition. You're trying to avoid repentance out of embarrassment. Trying to avoid repentance out of embarrassment. And so it's very important to put limitations on females' marketing sensuality. Very important. Otherwise, they're going to get more and more embarrassed because their involvement is so extreme. They're going to say, wow, it's going to take me so long to repent. I'm going to look really bad. You know, I don't want to look bad. I don't want to seem like I've been spiritually ambitious. You know, it's like that. But the women who can admit that they have been spiritually ambitious, definitely the road of repentance is right there. Vision of oneness is right there. They can get to it. Absolutely. It's just like they say to the men, hey, wait, why don't you do it for me? Yeah. It seems like difficult. You do it for me and come back and give me the product. Like they manipulate the male strong men, the two strong men. You know, one of them has something they want. Maybe both have something they want. So let me get them fighting. Maybe I can get some from both sides. I'll get one from which one's going to win. Let me pick a winner. Okay, I'll get a fight between the two of them, and I'll help out one of them by giving them a pretext to attack the other one, and then I'll be able to get, you know, half the treasure for myself, and manipulating like that. So when they look at the repentance, they say, hey, you know, this seems really difficult. Really difficult. I'm going to become embarrassed by this. If I struggle, I'm going to be embarrassed. I'm poised. Poised female, totally poised. You know, are you kidding me? Always cool, always poised, always beautiful. I don't want to struggle. Forget it. Okay, so man, you go get the repentance, like as if it were some good, some goal they can get, grasp it. You go get it and grasp it and bring it back to me, and I'll share it half and half with you. We'll be good. See, you do it. Doesn't work that way, does it? And so when that doesn't happen, and some men actually do repent and are free, the women say, where's my freedom? Where's my happiness? And they say, well, you gotta repent too. And they say, forget it. I'll be embarrassed by that. So, you know what? I think you guys are just crazy. You're waging some kind of sneaky campaign against us. You're trying to control us. And they start this whole war against men, really, against repentance. Say, repentance is bogus. It's all bogus. You guys didn't get us anything. You didn't bring anything back. We waited and waited and waited for you. You said you could get something for us, and now you didn't get us anything. Well, the men never said they could get something. I said, no, there's nothing to get. But the femme feminine is so used to manipulating men to get what they want. They think they can manipulate men to get them repentance, and it doesn't work. And then they get really mad and say, "Wow, well, I'm not going to do it. Are you kidding me? I'm not going to embarrass myself. I mean, what if I have a struggle, a difficult time? I'm not going to embarrass myself that way. So forget it, guys. Repentance is off the table, guys. Just letting you know, it's no longer, there is no God, there is no repentance. We're gonna build this beautiful, sensual world right here and call it good. Call it good. This is the situation that we're in here in this world." Now, repentance is difficult all the way to the vision of oneness. It is embarrassing, which is why we don't want to flout too much our struggles on the spiritual path. What I've done is just show that it's not too embarrassing, really. You know, it's mortifying, but not, you know, prohibitively so. It is tough. It is tough. I see these struggles, you know, I can't quite get it. It's right there. I can't quite get it. But traditionally, spiritual paths have been male and female separate, done on the quiet, in monasteries, nunneries, various places, you know, retreats. So neither side, neither, no one needs to really air their struggles, because it's very embarrassing. I mean, those who think they're so poised and beautiful, like, what? Me struggle? Why should I struggle? I don't have much to repent for. I'm beautiful. I'm a beautiful body. What are you talking about? Then they don't want us to be seen as struggling. You know, it's too embarrassing. So they'd rather lock themselves in a room. Don't let anybody know they're struggling. I mean, that's what I did. Lock myself in a room for a long time, really. It was very embarrassing. So it's important to point out, this is very salvational, compassionate work here. It is definitely, it's very embarrassing, especially if you thought you were really all that and great and no ambition, spiritual ambition at all, because it was so sneakily hidden. You know, it's embarrassing. It's more than embarrassment. It's a blow to your pride. Like, you thought, wow, I thought I manipulated everything so cleverly nobody knew. But all the while, you're perceiving and identifying with the body, which brings about a continuity problem without you even knowing it. It's automatic. It's automatic. Perception brings about continuity problem in a such a sneaky way that even women cannot see it, you know. Even the feminine can't see it. It's so sneaky. It's that stealthy. It's automatic. And so they're kind of embarrassed that they didn't see that, you know, because they thought, I should be clever enough to have seen that. And all the while they're manipulating, thinking, no, I can manipulate the situation to the point where, you know, people will just say, no, I don't have any spiritual ambition. You know, I can get a whole army of slaves to bow to me and worship me as the goddess and say, no, goddess, you are free of all spiritual ambition, goddess. You know, and that's what the world is going towards. The world is going towards goddess worship, going back to the old matriarchal ways of worshiping the goddess and saying, no, goddess, you have no spiritual ambition whatsoever. Or your spiritual ambition is justified and it's helping save me, that kind of thing. Because actually what they're worshiping is spiritual ambition. They just think it's so clever, it will trick God, and they won't have a continuity problem. You know, worshiping the goddess. The goddess is so wonderful, so clever, so tricky. She can even seduce God, intercessor with God, and say, God, you know, these people don't need to repent. Those who worship me don't need to repent. Right? Let's call it good. Otherwise, I'll turn into an old hag, and you're going to be so sorry. And God being the perfect spaciousness that doesn't judge any quality whatsoever, doesn't even hear it, you know, doesn't even hear it. But we think God hears it. So the goddess seems like this beautiful intercessor. We just worship her, and we don't have to repent. See, that's the hook, the hook. We're being hooked. Hooked by so many hookers in this world, actually. So many hookers of the goddess are at work in this world, making us think, hey, we don't have to repent. Why? We don't have to repent. She'll cut a deal with God, and God will see that she has no spiritual ambition or anything like that. And God will say, okay, you guys don't have to come back to reality. I'm sure you're happy here with her, with the goddess. So you know, no worries. This is all, of course, totally ludicrous, and yet it is what is what's happening. It's not that we have to go back to reality. We never left. We're already here. So inevitably that realization will dawn upon us, always dawning upon us. We have to frantically keep hallucinating blindness to not see it. So the idea that somehow worshiping the goddess is going to make us, we don't have to repent, all it means is that we're going to keep frantically hallucinating blindness. And the goddess is just a motivating tool to motivate us to keep doing that, because she says, hey, if you don't do that, I'm going to be totally embarrassed and I'll turn ugly on you, you know, and you won't be attracted to sensuality anymore. And then you'll lose your body sensuality perception, and you'll see oneness, and you'll freak you out. And you go, oh, no, please, goddess, I'll do anything you want, you know. This is the fear, you see, the fear that happens this way. And so it was this terrible enslavement of severe hallucination of blindness, which is what perception is. Now we can have healed perception. Healed perception is the goal of the Holy Spirit for us, which is seeing a vision of oneness, referencing the tree, the sky, the world, the universe, the table. It's this, the zero. Healed perception, the vision of oneness, is a healed perception, actually. That's the goal. But you're not going to get there by goddess worship at all, thinking that the goddess can cut a deal with God and say, you don't need to come back. Again, we never left. We have no choice but to, about that fact. It's not that we need to come back. We never left. Nothing ever left pure spaciousness. There's no going back. We've never left. We're already here. We're always here. And the only way we don't know that is to keep hallucinating severe blindness. So we become terrified of losing body awareness, body sensuality, body identification, perception, and we become so hooked and addicted to it out of fear. So it's a vicious circle, very much a vicious circle. A lot of great efforts have been made over the last, you know, thousands of years to work on this problem. This is under severe attack right now, severe attack by the goddess worshippers, the non-repenters, those who are so addicted to it, they're afraid, they're going to be so embarrassed by their ineffectual actions to free themselves, that they decided to double down. And they say, hey, we don't need to free ourselves. The goddess has cut a deal with God. God says, your kingdom is good. It's equal to mine, my kingdom. And you can dwell there and stay there forever. No problem. That's what they want. That's what they want. And they want to use this beautiful goddess to keep attracting them to sensuality, so they don't start, you know, losing interest in it and stop maybe hallucinating blindness so severely, right? Because, when we drop hallucination of blindness for an instant, we see the oneness, right? It's right there, like, whoa, oh, my gosh, I see it right now. Wow, where'd it go? Then, boom, back, start hallucinating blindness again. So again, we are hallucinating blindness. Okay, get that through. We're hallucinating blindness. The yin and yang, male and female, are doing the same hallucination of blindness, okay? And we've been hallucinating blindness for so long, we're afraid to stop hallucinating blindness. It's that simple. It's that simple. And yet so frightening for us. But again, if we say the only problem I have is the continuity fear, the continuity problem, I've been hallucinating blindness for so long, I'm afraid to let it go, then we can begin to work on it more directly. We work on it both directly and indirectly. There's a yin and the yang to the path, both directly and indirectly. So the male-female components of us, of direct and indirect, both are engaged on the path of repentance, of evaporating the continuity fear. Absolutely. You have to use both of them. You can't do it totally directly, you can't do it totally indirectly. It's a dance of direct and indirect, really. Okay, as you go along, each one sort of helps the other along in this way. So the male-female qualities, which we all have within us, these dynamics of defensiveness, really, of spiritual ambition, we now turn them in a dance towards evaporating the continuity fear. So it's possible for relationships, people to stay in relationships, and if they're both on the path, they can help each other out, help evaporate this continuity fear. This is what the Course in Miracles says, the way Jesus advises for people to tends to be people in relationships there, but it doesn't always work. It's not for everybody necessarily. The path of the more solitary path of distancing the male and female, etc., is also very helpful, works very well. But in this contemporary time, when that's been under a severe attack, then the starting point needs to be start to work in the relationship you're in. Now, that may be that someone doesn't want to work that way, but then you have to use the male-female aspects of yourself, not yourself, but of your blindness, your desire, your spiritual ambition. Direct and indirect, direct and indirect, direct and indirect, direct and indirect. You see? Not one favoring one over the other necessary. Whatever helps, helps. Sometimes direct, sometimes indirect. Like that. And welcome it both. Welcome the dance. Now, so this big lie that I've talked about here, this horrible big lie, which is being promulgated in this world, uses false flags, stirs up turmoil, stirs the pot here, gets people fighting, gets people agitated, and they just continually go in that direction. And there will be severe false flags coming up. I'm aware of that. But it's more important to focus on repentance than to say, what's going to happen, what's going to happen. Then we get all into all this intrigue and anger and all this stuff. But there's going to be a very bad one coming up for sure. Worst yet, for sure. And people will be totally shocked by it. I was shown what it is yesterday on Pentecost, and I hadn't seen it before, but I, no question, I saw it, and it fit everything that before I'd been shown. I just couldn't quite fit in what it is, because it's so terrible, really. And it's like, oh, wow, that's what is planned. So, everyone's called to repentance here. What's important is repentance. What happens to all these fearful events outside, we use them to say, hey, that's how my fear is coming from. My fear is coming from that catastrophe. It's not coming from my continuity fear. So we say, I don't have a continuity fear, I have a catastrophe fear. That's the purpose of all this stuff, along with stunning everybody into stupidity so they can then default to the goddess worship. That's also part of it. But really, if you look at it, the way of saying, I'm just seeing fear out there, projecting the continuity fear that I really have, which points out my spiritual ambition, the sin of spiritual ambition, the need of repentance. I project it out there and say, oh, no, my fear is because there's this big catastrophe that's going to come. There's this big catastrophe that just happened. That's where my fear is. So when these events happen, just brush it off and say, no. I don't have a catastrophe fear. I have a continuity fear. No way. My fear is the continuity fear. Catastrophe fear is nothing. It's nothing. It's nothing. There's no value to me. No value. So say, I do not have a catastrophe fear. I have a continuity fear. The catastrophe fear has zero value for me. You know, only the vision of oneness has value for me. Insist upon it. As I'm saying, this is very important for us to be doing this, because this false flag, it's both a false flag and a severe disaster coming up. That's going to cause a lot of people a lot of trouble, for sure. But if you are able to say, I do not have a catastrophe problem, I have a continuity problem. The catastrophe problem has no value for me whatsoever, zero value. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And so I listen to the Holy Spirit, and I'm working on evaporating my continuity fear, both indirectly and directly. I'm going through this beautiful dance of indirect and direct, not trying to favor one or the other, just intuitively, spiritually, under the guidance of the Holy Spirit, which is neither male nor female, evaporating the continuity fear. Then these disasters won't slow you down. You won't even break stride. You'll say, yeah, I know. I expected it. I knew it was coming. Okay. I don't have a catastrophe problem. I have a continuity problem. It's a very severe continuity problem. Got to work on that. Sorry. Got to go. Got to work on that. Got to keep working on this. It's a protection. It's a tremendous protection. I mean, I was found out what this catastrophe, this plan, is. And it was quite shocking and quite wow. And it took me, you know, I tried to sleep on it, couldn't sleep all last night. In the morning I used this, hey, I don't have a catastrophe problem, I have a continuity problem. And the Holy Spirit told me, just use that today. I don't have a catastrophe problem, I have a continuity problem. The catastrophe problem has zero value for me. Zero value, zero value. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. Only the vision of oneness has value for me. And immediately I was centered, I was calm, I felt peace entering my mind again. I've been able to do this taping like this. Even knowing now what it is that's coming, I'm able to keep my poise like this through using this technique. Without this technique, I would be flailing around right now, that is for sure. So I do not have a catastrophe problem, I have a continuity problem. So we don't need to try and stop the catastrophe, you know, because that becomes like, oh my, I've tried to do it before, you know, try to stop the various things that I saw coming, and it plunged my life into a hell, just a hell. You know, nobody wanted to stop it. You see, people don't want to stop these things. They want these things to happen so that they can blame their fear, see the fear outside of them, say, this is what I'm afraid of, not the continuity fear. So I don't need to repent. And oh, here's the goddess who's saying, guess what? You don't need to repent because I made a deal with God. If you just worship me, I'll keep this deal on. But if you make me angry, I'll go to God and say, hey, I want to cancel this deal. These people really are not treating me well. And then you'll lose your deal. And then you do need to repent. And you don't know how to. See, it's a vicious trap. A vicious trap. Goddess worship is a vicious trap. It really is terrible. Get that again. If you don't be enslave yourself to the goddess will say, hey, you know, you're not treating me the way I want to be treated. So you're not doing identification that I want you to do. So I'm going to go to God and call the whole deal off. See? And the answer is, there was no deal. There is no deal. God doesn't make any deals at all. Why does God didn't make a deal? So God gave the Holy Spirit that deal to deal with the continuity issue. Okay, that's the only quote-unquote deal. But it's a pragmatic, temporary kind of thing to help us let go of this hallucination of blindness. That's all. But as far as any other quote-unquote deal, there isn't any. There isn't any. We're already dwelling in the kingdom. Kingdom is everywhere. There's only one kingdom and it's everywhere. So there's no deal the goddess makes with God whatsoever. But we're willing to believe that nonsense. But once we believe it, then the fear of her calling off the deal terrifies us. Terrifies us. And we become abject slaves to fear under those conditions. It's a pretty nasty situation that we've got ourselves into, for sure. The way out is to suffer is humility. Is humility is the way out. Humility is the greatest virtue. Patience is part of humility. Every day is very humbling because you know another day you're still afraid of the vision of oneness. You know? It speaks to a long history of involvement in spiritual ambition, right? Every day speaks to another day, and so humility, humble, like wow. Humility is the path. It is the path of you. The path of humility is the path. The path of repentance is the path of humility. Being willing to work at it again, give it everything you got and still fail. You know, don't play the game of, well, if I work real hard and I fail, it's even more embarrassing to me, so I won't work very hard. And when I fail, I'll say, well, you know, I didn't really work that hard. If I had, I probably would have succeeded. That's the game, the tricky game that the ego gets us into. So what we should do is try, make every means possible every day to succeed. I feel like I've given 100% every day and still I fail. So that's embarrassing. If I said, well, no, I only tried 10%. If I tried 100, I'm sure I would have succeeded. That's self-delusion. It's delusion. Now you're gonna fail. Even if you give 100% every day, you're still going to have fear for quite some time. So humility, humility, humility from both male and females. Everyone's a sinner. Everyone has a sin of spiritual pride, spiritual ambition. Everyone has a severe continuity problem. Severe. It's going to take everybody a long time to repent from it. Even when we give 100%, it's going to take quite a long time to get to the vision of oneness, which is we're already there, which means the entire thing was nothing but spiritual ambition. Entirely. Entirely. You see, we think some of it was and some of it wasn't. That's a lie. All of it has been. Hallucinating blindness is spiritual ambition. All of it. All of it. All of it. And that's the tough part. To realize we never went anywhere. We've been just blinded. We've been hallucinating blindness the entire time. There's no other cause whatsoever. It is our own desire, spiritual ambition, which hallucinates blindness. That's the only cause of it all. It isn't any other cause. So it's 100% our own spiritual ambition. 100%. We're willing to go 99. You know, the spiritual path's like a bargaining. I'll go 50-50. Then, well, I'll go 55-45. You know. How about 60-40? How about 70-30? How about 80-20? All right, 90-10, final offer. All right, 95-5. And then, finally, okay, 99-1. That's it, final offer. Take it or leave it. 99-1. No, still total delusion. How about 99.999? See, and 0.111. No, still totally. No, it's 100%. 100% our own spiritual pride that is the cause of all of this. Causes our hallucinating of blindness, which keeps us from seeing the oneness. The oneness isn't 99.99% oneness. It's 100% oneness. And the fact that we don't see it is spiritual pride. There is no other cause for it whatsoever. No other cause for it whatsoever. No other cause for it whatsoever. Now, back to the women again. They have a tough time because the other women say, hey, you're going to make us look bad. You know, I'm sure you run into that. Saying, I want to repent. And start struggling, and the other women, the ones who don't want to repent and think that they can be the goddess, say, hey, sister, you're making us look real bad. I mean, you're trying to repent, and you have trouble, and people are saying, hey, why is she having so much trouble? Maybe she's got a lot of spiritual pride. Maybe you're making us look bad. So there's enormous pressure on women to not even take the spiritual path from the goddess, the mother patriarchal complex, saying you're going to make us look bad because you're struggling, having a hard time, and then people will look at you and say, okay, you know, you got a lot of pride and you need to repent and it's difficult for you. And then they'll look at the goddess and say, well, you're just the same. You know, I don't see a difference. The goddess says, no, you know, horrors. So the goddess culture puts enormous pressure on women, enormous, horrible pressure on women to conform, to bow to the goddess and say, to get unified, unify, sisterhood, the sisterhoods, and let's all get together and blame men together so we don't mortify ourselves. But there's a lot of women saying, whoa, wait a minute. Yeah, I don't like this deal. I feel like I'm going into a trap, which they most certainly are. And they say, no, I want to repent. I need to repent because I want to drop this idiocy of death and sickness and fatigue and confusion and fear and depression and anger and conflict and sneakiness and all this hell, you know, this hell of spiritual ambition. I want to drop it. I want to work on the continuity problem. But as they struggle, they look like, wow, I'm really having a terrible time. Then everybody will see that and say, wait a minute, goddess, you know, you seem very similar to me. Maybe you need to repent too, goddess. You see, so the goddess culture has put this massive propaganda brainwashing campaign towards women to make sure that no women repents, not a single one. And then unified, they can turn to men and say, men, we don't have spiritual ambition. We're going to go directly to God, make a deal with the God, and God says, okay, you, all of you can worship the goddess. You don't have to go back home to God. God says, fine, we'll share will share reality. You can have your separate kingdom. You don't have to deal with any continuity problem as long as you worship the goddess. And the goddess then will control you by saying, look, you're not doing what I want you to do. You're not worshiping me enough because I still feel nervous or something, making me feel uncomfortable, which is really the inner continuity fear. And they'll say, we're going to break off the deal with God. God's not keeping the side of the bargain. I'm not happy with the deal. I'm going to say I don't want it. And, you know, you're on your own. You're on your own. And then those slaves will just freak out, you know, terrified of this, terrified. So you're going into a slave situation, a horrible situation where you have to defend the goddess at every turn. So your conscience will torture you. Your conscience will absolutely torture you in doing this. Because you know you're doing everyone wrong. You're doing yourself wrong. You're doing the goddess wrong. You're doing the men wrong. Absolutely, your conscience will just torture you. Torture you. So it's not a good thing. Then what happens is you try to drown your conscience in drugs and sensuality, right? And then you end up becoming this very sensual, drugged out, debauched kind of, you know, action. And then you really feel mortified. And then you really feel more embarrassed to say, my God, I'm so embarrassed, I can't repent because I'm so embarrassed. And it goes on and on and on and on that way. You know, it's a vicious trap. Forgiveness, 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 forgiveness. Wisdom doesn't judge in the way that the ego judges. Wisdom just says, hey, you got a severe continuity problem. You got to start working on it. That's all. Just patience, humility, perseverance, humility, humility, humility. It's okay. You'll get it eventually, for sure. So if you're going to succeed for sure, how mortified can you be? I'll tell you the truth. The Holy Spirit told me for sure I'm going to succeed, guaranteed. So I said, okay. And I believe the Holy Spirit. I will succeed some days. Eventually I will have the vision of oneness for sure. I don't know when, but the Holy Spirit guarantees it. So that's very important. To get this guarantee, and the Holy Spirit gives you a glimpse of it. You get a glimpse of it. You say, ah, the Holy Spirit says, you will have this. Just persevere. Be humble, humble, humble. Humility. But the more you go into this horrible goddess worship, deal with God, you know, I don't need to repent stuff, the more embarrassed you get. You don't listen to your conscience and all this stuff. And you feel like, God, it's just, I don't know if I have the humility, you know, to do this. It gets difficult, really difficult. But you have to. You have to do it. You have to do it. May do it slowly. May do it sneakily. May have a lifetime where you just kind of cool out, you know, cool away from all this stuff. And then another one where you kind of turn even further away from it. And then the lifetime will just start working on it. You know, it can get so bad it does take lifetimes of cooling down, backing away from, you know, the goddess worship, the sensuality, the drugs, all this stuff, the fear, the terror. The slave enslavement to the fear the goddess is going to break off the deal with God and all this stuff. It might take lifetimes, and before you're really willing to say, okay, I'm going to go for it. You know, well, you have enough humility there. You say, I think I know I can do it, and it's not going to be too humiliating for me. Possible, right? Or the grace of God could enable you to be humble in this lifetime and work through it, which I have tried to do. Struggled very badly, for sure. Now, of course, we our spiritual ambition wants to make a side deal with God. So we don't want to admit that we have troubles. See, we want to say, God, there's no troubles at all. God, do it. You know, I wasn't blind. I wasn't blind. The duality is really there. It's really there. I just decided I really don't need to work on it. I don't want to work on it anymore or something. No, it's not there. It's not there. Duality is not there. We're seeing something that's not there. Which means hallucinating blindness. So, this is the big picture. But because of the false flag, we need to repent and say, you know what, let me exercise as much humility as I can. Let me give it a year, let me give it 2 years. You know, just take a target and say, I'm going to be work on with humility on the continuity problem, both directly and indirectly, for the foreseeable future. Let's give it, you know, a number of years, several years. You know, I always say, well, several more years kind of thing. You don't have to put an end point on it, because then it might get really humiliating. But just say, you know what, I think I have a really severe continuity problem. I know I do. And so let me work on it for several years with great humility and effort. You see? And then at the end of that period, say, you know what? I probably have, you know, maybe you know, several more years I can work on it. This is the smart way. Be smart. Don't say, I'm going to succeed right now or today or this lifetime. Say, I'm going to try everything I can to succeed in a couple years, several years. Give it my best shot and go forward that way. But the pressure's on everybody right now. The goddess culture's put pressure on the women who put pressure on the men. Don't embarrass us. The women say, I don't want to embarrass the goddess, you know, because I'll lose all leverage, you know, and I'll be on just on the path, you know, and I think it'll be too much for me. So they say to the men, hey, don't embarrass me so I don't embarrass the goddess. So if we point this out, maybe there's some who say, I see it. I can see that. So let's use some humility. We can afford to be humble. Use some humility. Humility, absolutely. Absolutely. Now we all want these gurus who like, yeah, I can enlighten you and easy. Just come see me. You'll get it. You'll be enlightened. So we say, oh good. I might be able to do it like in a weekend, you know. And I don't want to embarrass the goddess, you know. I don't want to embarrass the woman, you know. That'll embarrass her, and she'll be embarrassed the goddess. And what are you doing having a man who can't get in a weekend? Or the woman say, well, what are you doing being a woman that can't get it? Quick, come on. You don't have any spiritual pride. Get it quick. So these gurus will show up. They'll say, no problem. Come to my seminar. Come here. And you should easily get enlightened. So we're vulnerable to those types of gurus. You know, there's no way. There is no way you're going to just get it like that. You know, not permanently, no way. You might get a glimpse. But there's no way. We have a severe continuity problem. Everybody does. Severe. I've gotten help from the best teachers in history, and I still haven't succeeded. I've gotten help from the Holy Spirit every single day. Still haven't succeeded. And I've worked at it with tremendous humility and effort. Still haven't succeeded. So you're not going to get it. You know, so, I mean, the guru, but this is the culture we live in. This shows you the fear we live in. The fear, tremendous fear we live in. Of this goddess culture, this big lie being told is you better be able to get it quick because you don't want to make me look bad, don't want to embarrass me, I don't have any spiritual pride, I don't need to repent, and I don't want any worshipers of me who need to repent either. You know, come on, I made a deal with God, don't you understand that? You don't need to repent. So what are you doing? You want to do it quick, whatever. So we get these gurus who instant enlightenment. I can give you enlightenment, you can get it, you'll get it, just come to see me, you'll get it. Not true. I mean, look, people go see Ramana Maharshi. Very few got it, if any. Very few, if any. They stay a long, long time with him, you know. Long time. Same with the great gurus. Very few got it. But they certainly made enormous progress towards it. Maybe they'll get it their next lifetime. Probably, right? Maybe they don't even need to return. Maybe they, you know. They got it a cloak, got it enough that there's no need to identify a perception anymore. Don't need perception anymore. Very possible. Very possible. So don't be looking for the gurus who are there to give you instant enlightenment. You know, the whole guru trip thing, like, come to me, I'm the big guru, and for sure all you have to do is I can solve your problems. What's your problem? Tell me what it is. Okay, just it's easy. Just see the one. You know, drop the hallucination of blindness, see the one, and you're cured. Oh, thank you. Thank you. Thank you. You said I'm cured. Well, almost cured. Oh, good. Okay. I'm done. I did it quick. How long did it take? It's like a 4-day seminar. I got it. Guess what, guys? I got it in 4 days. It turns out I didn't have much ambition at all, you know. And she goes, oh, great. Yeah, I know. And see, we don't really have much ambition at all, do we? We're okay. We don't have a continuity problem. On and on it goes. So at the least, go to a situation where you say, you know, a couple years of effort here. Maybe a year, yeah, a couple years of humility, of each day realizing you're probably not going to get it. Probably not going to get it. Go to the teachers where you realize you're probably not going to get it, but you're going to get the opportunity to really work with humility, to work and fail, and nobody's going to judge you, and you understand you got this severe continuity problem, and you get these techniques, and you will then be able to center yourself over and over and over again, and keep making great progress. So eventually, you'll feel you know, they're able to accept the vision of oneness. Vision of oneness. Vision of oneness is really something, for sure. Having glimpsed it, I'm telling you. It's pure happiness. I mean, it's just nothing but happiness. It is nothing but relief. It is pure relief. Oh my God, nobody ever left. Nobody's ever left. You see it. Nobody has ever left reality. Everyone is still 100% in reality. Everyone is totally supported by zero, zero, zero problems as far as that's concerned of separation. There is no separation. There is. There's never been any separation. You see it. And it's just like, oh my God. The relief is just incredible relief, pure relief. And just this, you're on fire with relief, on fire with relief. That doesn't mean that someone else is going to get it from you, because they still have their path of working out the continuity fears. And that may take them a lifetime. Just as it, for me, it's taken me a lifetime of effort. I still don't have it. So, of course, it's going to take others also a long time. Maybe they can do it quicker. Maybe not. Doesn't really matter. What is going to take a lot of effort for sure. In any case, it's going to take a lot of effort. That's what Shankara of India, his great Shankara, said, hey, just look at it like it's going to be a lifetime of effort. Don't look at it any differently than that. Because in almost every case, it will be at least a lifetime of effort, if not more. And a few exceptions, those are people who've already spent a lifetime previously. So just look at it like it's going to be a lifetime endeavor. But in this day and age, that's too much for people. So look at it like it will be a several-year endeavor, or a year, or several years. Course of Miracles says, give it 1 year of doing the exercise. Just 1 year, Jesus says. Give it 1 year. Now, I gave it a year, and I'm still, that was like 36 years ago or something, right? 36, I'm still working on it. But then you realize you can do it. You can get into it, and the hope is there. So give it a year, give it 2 years. You know, maybe today, give it 6 months. I don't know. Give it a month. In today's world, the pressure's on some people so badly. I don't even know. You know what? How much humility people can employ at all? And then it's important to go to a guru or teacher who doesn't look like a guru or teacher, because then you can blame it on them. You know, when you fail after a year, you say, well, you know, he's not some heavyweight guru, you know. Whereas if you go to this guru's all decked out in the whole guru thing, you know, and you don't get it, you can't blame it on them. You say, oh, yeah, I wasn't able to do it. Scared, I wasn't able to do it. It was not the guru's fault, it's my fault. But, wow, I can't admit that, I better not go back. Whereas if you go to someone who doesn't look like a guru, the whole thing's not there, you say, well, you know, it's very helpful, but, you know, he's not a heavyweight guru or anything, so it was, you know, it didn't really help me as much as I needed to be helped, and there's that wiggle room, you see. So you can say, well, it wasn't really my fault entirely here, you know, and then you can say, and it gives you some room. So yeah, maybe, I made progress, so I'm going to go, you know, keep working on it, and, you know, that way, see, it's better that way. If you go to the gurus and get the instant enlightenment, then, oh my gosh, you know, you say, then you fail, it's your fault, it's not the guru's fault, and then where does it leave you? Worship the goddess. Say, I need the form of enlightenment. Just give me the form. This is too scary. Oh, you saved me because you're going to give me the form of enlightenment. You made a deal with God. Ah, I'm saved. That's great. Your fear, you rush right back in the arms of the goddess worship. Right back in the arms with this thing. So, the Holy Spirit says, tells me, don't look like a guru. Don't look like a teacher. I don't want you that way. I want you to look like you're not even a teacher at all. You know, really? Not much of one. So it gives people this wiggle room they need, you know. They don't have to rush back on the goddess and say, well, you know, goddess, I failed, but it wasn't all my fault, my failure, you know. And so I still think it's partly me, and I'm going to keep working on it, you know. So like that. See, that's way better. That's way better. So this is fun. For me, I'm sort of like letting the light speak here, letting the light speak. And I'm just like, wow, light, this is great. This is really wonderful. Thank you for speaking this way, light. Yeah, I'm just stream of consciousness, light, just letting it speak. So it's not channeling or anything. I'm just stream of consciousness. I'm just stream of consciousness and just saying whatever I'm comfortable saying, and just like, wow, it's heavy, heavy stuff, great stuff, great stuff here, great stuff. So I'll see how I react to this. It's shocking. So I'm not gonna pressure too much. Like, usually it takes me a day to, you know, work this through. Okay, very great. I hope some of this is sunk in the right way, and you say, hey, you know, the path of humility is possible. There's a way to, get there, isn't there? I'm not totally trapped, actually. Remember, false flags are coming. I better get into some humility right now. 100% work at 100%. Oh, I failed today. That's okay. 100% tomorrow. That's okay. Let me have a couple years of failure. 100% going to 100% failing. At least I know, that I've for sure made a ton of progress in the 100% effort, right? For sure. Every day, actually, 100% effort to make a ton of progress. Absolutely. It's just that the continuity fear is really severe. So it does take quite a bit of breakthroughs, quite a bit of breakthroughs. But again, in a certain lump of time, if you practice humility, you can make a ton of breakthroughs. No question about it. So just go for it. All right.